And good morning. It's time now for Coach's Corner, live from McDonald's on Madison's Hilltop. I'm Tim Torrance. Thanks for tuning us in. We do it every Saturday morning from the McDonald's across the Madison High School. This morning, we're going to talk boys track with Madison boys track coach Scott Holcroft. Good morning, Coach.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. And you?
Oh, enjoying this warm weather finally.
It is almost springtime since we've been almost spring for about a month. But it weather affects every sport, every way. It doesn't, I mean, even if you're an indoor sport, it still affects you some way, shape, or form. But for you guys, it has a lot of effect on it, and not in a good way either.
Yeah, it really does. We've, you know, made the best we can. A lot of weightlifting, a lot of cross training, a lot of running through the halls. But, you know, for some of those field event guys, when we had our first meet, you know, they've run through a couple or three times on long jump was it, or pole vault, or, you know, discus. You know, there's just so many things you can't do inside. It makes it tough.
You can do some things, and I guess for you, it's like everybody else. When you go inside and you're forced to do that, your focus has to change on what you're wanting to accomplish something, but it's not exactly what you're intending to.
Right, yeah. You know, if you look at the poor distance guys, their mileage that they've gotten in this spring has been, you know, way down compared to where we usually are. And you know, I told them the other day, we're going to run through the season to get in shape. And like for the first couple meets, you know, we've been putting all those guys in the 4x8 relay, the mile, the 2 mile, or the half, and then the 4x4, and the poor 2 milers, my son included, comes through, finishes the 2 mile, and has to turn around and run the 4x4. And you know, we're doing it just to run into shape, to try and get as much in as we can on decent days.
Put you behind the eight ball a little bit, kind of put you behind in the season. I think you make a great point. Now you're starting the beginning of the season, but you're actually starting the season training kind of for the midseason.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, it's tough on some of the guys, especially the new guys. They're not used to that. They're going, well, I'm not rested. Why didn't I didn't do very well? Well, it's in the end that really what matters.
Mm-hmm. You look at track as a whole, and getting new guys and getting them acclimated, and starting in the gym is not the best way to do it, but they have to learn somehow and sometime.
Yeah, and you know, we've got many drills. I got spots through the school and in the halls that you got to be at this point at this time and things like that. Mm-hmm. And a lot of form stuff. You know, I guess that's probably the only good thing about this, is it really gave us a lot of time to work on the guys' running form and things like that, which in the end is also going to benefit them.
How many seasons now for you?
I was looking the other day. I had to start a junior high track meet, and the last time I started one of those was 95. And I know I was helping Coach Wilcox then, as an assistant. So yeah, 20 plus years now.
I know this is a silly question, because if you've done it this long, you never get tired of it.
No, I really don't. And you know, the great things is I get to see these guys later on. And just like last night, I got to talk to Wayne a little bit. He was heading to Tennessee to watch the most of the U.S. 4x1 Olympic last year 4x1 team run today. And they invited him down. So, you know, those are the things that make it special. And I just enjoy being around the guys.
You talk about guys coming back, and there's been some special athletes, and you know, there's those select athletes that really excel, and you talk about Wayne, but they come through, but they're kind of few and far between.
Yeah, they are. And you know, one of the greatest honors is my coaches, Coach Lamb and Coach Hall. You know, Coach Hall does the distance, Coach Lamb does the shot put, and both of them ran under me. So you know, that's a heck of a reward. And to have those guys come back and want to give to the program and do what they're doing, it's, you know, it's what makes it worth it.
You put together a track program, and you've got to start somewhere, and you've got to learn all the ins and outs. And you know, being a part of a track program, you kind of learn 1 year to the next year to the next year. But for you, how's it changed over the last 15 years or so?
Yeah, a lot of it is just numbers. Yeah. You know, getting the guys out, and I think coaching football, helping Coach Morrison, helps a lot to get more guys out. You know, I enjoy being around those guys. It's fun. Mm-hmm. They enjoy it. And, you know, when they go to school and talk about it and they're wearing their track uniform or their track T-shirt and their track sweat jacket and things like that, you know, more people come out. And it's amazing, you know, the new guys that come out as juniors and seniors, and they go, man, I wish I'd have done this all 4 years. You know, it's recruiting. I mean, it really is. And being over watching the junior high and being in the junior high now, I think will help because those kids are seeing me a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that's a big part of it.
You build those special bonds with the kids that come through, and whether they're an outstanding track athlete or just kind of a novice track athlete, you build those bonds that, well, they last a lifetime.
They do, you know, it's amazing when you're out at Walmart or Kroger's or here or there, and, hey, coach, and you turn around, and it takes a minute, I got to think, you know, what year was he?
Yeah.
But you know, it is nice, and oh, I'm going to be at a meet this week, or I'm going to come by and see guys and how are they doing. And you know, always a track runner, you know, they all are always still interested.
So. You, and I asked you just a minute ago about kind of how things have changed. As far as an athlete goes, training and preparing, has that changed a lot over the last 15 years?
You know, in the last few years, we've really gone to a lot of the core stuff. Mm-hmm. I really think that's helped our injuries. Mm-hmm. We're seeing fewer and fewer injuries. It's a great workout, you know, cardiovascular, doing that indoors, which helps tremendously that we do have stuff we can do.
Right.
And so, you know, that's been one of the biggest changes. I know when I ran, and that's been a long time ago, we did aerobics and stuff. And, mm-hmm. and, you know, same thing, just different. But it really has helped the guys.
And you want to cut down on those injuries. I mean, injuries in track are like injuries in any other sport. They happen whether you want them to or not. Of course, nobody wants to have an injury, but they occur.
Yeah, they do. And Dante, you know, he was our MVP last year. He injured his leg in weight class the other day. And the trainer, Dave, told us, you know, it could be a couple weeks. And we're like, oh, here we go. And luckily, it wasn't as bad as what he thought. And he came back in our second meet and, you know, running, and it's fine. But when in track, when you get an injury, especially a pulled hamstring or something like that, our season's so short that, you know, we're already a month away and we're into the tournament, and for those guys, they're done. And it's important they warm up and get ready.
And we talk about it as coaches about warming up and stretching properly and all that business that goes with it, but man, on a cold day, especially when you're outside, if you don't take care of things, that come back and get you.
Yeah, and you know, that's the thing that worries me when we have some of these early meets and, you know, watching that temperature and that kind of stuff. Mm. Because, you know, I, like you said earlier, I don't care if you're the very best or, you know, an average Joe, whatever. Mm-hmm. You're not going to run if it's, you know, if I feel that it's unsafe. Mm-hmm. And because no one, you know, we don't want anybody hurt.
Yeah. Coach, let's go back and reflect on, I always like to go back and reflect on a year ago, kind of summary of your last track season.
You know, last year had a lot of kids. Again, this year we were running about 31, 32 guys. The biggest thing last year was we were pretty young, didn't have a lot of seniors. Stahl, you know, was one of our top seniors. Mm-hmm. And, you know, did well. You know, he just missed going to the state meet. And you know, track's interesting because you look at it as a team, but you also look at individuals. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that would have been great for him to make 2 years. You know, he lost out on his last, or the guy's last jump beat him by an inch. And, you know, great season because he wasn't even supposed to be able to run. Mm-hmm. But overall, with injuries, Brewer was hurt last year and that kind of stuff too. And so we had a good season. We're off to a great start this year.
Yeah, you get off to a great start. You finish the season, get off to a great start this year. And of course, you know, you're done with the track season last year, and it's summertime, and then it's fall, and kids are doing things. Do you see kids working towards track year-round? Do you see that much, or do they just participate in other sports to get ready for the track season?
Mainly participating in other sports. You know, the distance guys all go to cross-country, and mm-hmm. so they're running. We try and get them, you know, as soon as we come back after Christmas break, the guys right. that aren't doing other sports, and get them in lifting and running and a couple of 3 days a week just to get them into shape and get ready. And then as the fall or winter sports end, you know, then we start picking up more and more guys.
Right. It's cross country and track, and I've talked to coaches that really like the correlation between the two. If you're going to do one, you really need to do the other one because we help each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they do, and you know, one you're just running out through the yards, and the other you're going in circles. But we, you know, most of those guys do both. You know, we usually get a few soccer guys come out that are more of our sprinter mid distance guys, mm-hmm. and then you know, we've picked up some basketball players this year, and that's really helped. You know, it's great for them to sure. get them into shape to mm-hmm. go into the summer conditioning and training for them.
We've talked about the correlation between sports, you know, from one season to the next, and you know, all the coaches that I've talked to encourage participation in other sports. But you can use your sport on both sides of it. With playing basketball helps you in track, or playing track helps you in basketball, or something along that line. But it works together so well. At least they're doing something.
Exactly.
And that's what you want them to be doing.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, one of the biggest things that we've talked to some of the guys that want to go on and try and play football or basketball or soccer or run track is that if a school's looking at them and they're a multi-sport athlete, you know, their stock's kind of better with that coach because they know they're more versatile mm-hmm. than they are just doing one sport. And, you know, when they're looking at two guys, if they're going to give them a scholarship or something, and the guy that was, you know, ran track and made it to regionals is better than just the basketball, you know,
right.
or the football.
Sure.
Or the
yeah, and that's a great point, too, because, you know, it you don't want to spread kids too thin, but if they're a multi-sport athlete, especially going to the next level, and I know a lot of talk lately about doing multiple things and it kind of putting that on your resume, so to speak, going to college.
Yeah, and like I said, it, you know, that could be the deciding factor that, wow, they made state or they made regionals on a relay or in an individual running event. And, you know, that's big.
You get to the end of last year, and, of course, like I said, you know, everybody does their own thing, goes to summer and then back to school in the fall and this and that. Do you, as a coach, you get done with the track season and kind of assess how the season was and maybe things as a coach you need to either change, improve on, or work forward to?
You do. You know, you always have that in the back of your mind, and it's just like after, you know, a meet, I go home and start working on all the results to send out to you guys, mm-hmm. and you know, I sit there and look, man, we needed one more point, or we needed, you know, and you go, well, I could have moved him, I should have done this, and again, same thing with the end of the season. You know, you kind of look back and go, well, maybe we should have done this. You know, how can I get this guy out next year? Mm-hmm. And even during the season, you know, you're going back and going, man, I wish he would have come out this
yeah.
year and things like that.
Do you see a kid just basically how they're built or their stock or whatever and think, wow, you'd be great at something and try
yeah.
to get him to come and run track?
Yeah, a perfect example was Dita. you know, he was walking those halls over there, and I'm going, you ought to think about track. Oh, I don't run, coach. You know? And I got him out, and you know, he made the state track meet.
Yeah.
And you know, I really wish he would have tried in college the long jump.
Right.
I really think he would have been great, but he's doing great in basketball. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, you're always trying to get or telling the kids, hey, talk to him. We need him.
Right. You, when you get a kid too, and it kind of on the other side of the coin that comes to you, and I want to run track, but I don't know what I want to do, or I don't know what I'm going to be good at. How do you assess that talent?
You know, we bring them out, we watch them practice. You know, you can tell a lot by a kid when they practice if they're going to be a sprinter, a mid-distance, or distance, or mm-hmm. field event. Once you kind of see that, then these first few meets, we move them around, let them try things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the freshmen especially.
Right.
And, you know, it's interesting because they always seem to, you know, kind of flow to where they want to be, but mm-hmm. yet beneficial to the team and beneficial where they can be successful for the team. And, you know, in some of these meets, like this week, we placed five places. And, mm-hmm. you know, you see guys going, well, I'll try that.
Yeah.
Hey, I can get a ribbon maybe, you know. you know, that's the neat thing about it.
Mm-hmm. Coach, you mentioned the junior high. You mentioned them a couple of times. Junior high track program is no different than any other junior high program. You're getting ready to go to the high school and cross the ditch and do bigger and better things over there. But, man, how does it help you guys at the varsity level?
It really does. You know, they've got a great group of eighth graders. They've, you know, been very successful this year in football and basketball, and we're seeing the same thing in track. You know, the nice thing is I get to start a couple of the meets, so I get to see the kids. I see them during practice. Yesterday we had a lighter workout practice, mainly field events and blocks and things like that. So a lot of the junior high kids came around. They were there, and I had Bryce and some of my sprinters showing them the blocks, talking to them about them, showing some of the drills we do, that kind of stuff, just kind of getting them familiar with our program and what we do,
right.
So that when they come over, it's a lot easier.
They know you. They see what it's like at the varsity level. You get them acclimated, and you know. And again, that same premise that you talk about in high school with talk to your friends about coming out holds true at the junior high level. If you get them started earlier, that's even better.
Yeah, and their numbers between the boys and girls, I think they said they have almost 100 kids out for track, fifth through mm-hmm. eighth grade,
yeah.
and now that the fifth graders are doing it, you know, I'm hoping to see, you know, more and more kids come out. And then, of course, with the Molly DeTillo mm-hmm. run coming up next month,
right.
you know, we go down and work it as a mm-hmm. team because of the money they, you know, support
sure.
us with. And, you know, seeing those kids at that level and letting them see my athletes in their sweatsuits and stuff. and you know, it just all kind of flows together.
It does. And again, that can you start too early in track? You talk about fifth graders, but can you, I mean, is that too early?
No, I mean, you know, I've thought before about having a camp,
mm-hmm.
But it's tough because, you know, it'd be probably July when I'd have it. Kids are, you know, already
right.
into baseball and that kind of stuff.
Right.
And so, it would be something that I've really talked about,
mm-hmm.
but I just think it'd be pretty hard to get enough kids there
mm-hmm.
to make it worthwhile.
Let's talk about this season. It's been a challenging season for everybody outside this spring, but you know, kind of go through what you guys have gone through leading up to today.
Yeah, it really has. You know, you look back, and I think we got out in maybe February a couple times, and then we got into March and spring break, and it was snowing and raining every day, and you know, it's been tough. We went into our first meet. I think this is probably the only time this has ever happened, is we had not practiced really a 4x1 handoff, and not because we didn't want to, because the weather
right.
wasn't, you know, allowing
yeah.
us to. And so we looked at it. We had a couple freshmen on there with Foy and Winters, and who are, you know, junior or sophomore and senior, and I said, just get the baton around the track, you know, and we did, and we did
right.
fine.
Right.
But you know, it's tough, and you know, it just makes it really hard when you're stuck inside like this to get a lot of stuff done.
You're trying to get outside and get your work in and get to meets, and of course, as track goes, if it's cold out, you're still going to have a meet.
Yeah. We, the other day, you know, we ran on Tuesday, and by the time we finished up, it was 8:30, you know, at four teams, boys and girls,
right.
and it was about, you know, 38 degrees, and you know, hard coach I am, it's take your sweats off, you're running in their compression shorts and their tank top, and
right.
I said, run fast and get them back on.
And it's those challenges, but it's that dedication too. If you're gonna run the track, you got to take the bad with the good.
Yeah, and you know, the interesting thing the other night with the Scottsburg meet, it came down to the last two events. We were tied with them. Our 2 mile was getting ready to step on the track. We talked to the kids. We told them, and my three 2-milers that were in the the race stepped up. We said we had to split Scottsburg or beat them, and all three of them beat the Scottsburg kids. So that pretty much, it didn't solidify the meet. And then our 4x4 relay team was next, and I told them, and they ran probably the best time we've had in a couple or 3 years, and by themselves.
Right.
And, you know, it's amazing what a little bit of hype and things will do, and, and, you know, the kids are really feeding off of that meet.
You have a meet, and you get through it, and, of course, then you look and see who's excelled or who's done what you expected to, or maybe who – do you address, you know, the good and the not so good after a meet?
Yeah, I mean that's, you know, part of it.
Yeah.
And we go in and, you know, the next day and hand out ribbons. We give extra effort awards for anybody that has personal bests on the night, because you know, if a kid gets a personal best, then they're improving. You know, they may be a freshman, they may never get a first place, but they're improving and they're going to help the team, whether it be in the meet, in practice, because they're working harder pushing the number one guy or the number three guy to get better. So we address that, and then we look at the events and say, you know, it's happened before. Here's where you are. If you could have, you know, beaten that guy, you know, in track, you think 1 point. Well, when we get a point, the other team loses a point. So, you know, and then if you go from, you know, from third to second, it's a 3-point swing, you know, and so it's kind of weird, you know, the way the scoring goes, but when you look at that and say, you know, you got beat down in the stretch, you know, could you have done that? If right there, it changes the meet. So we address a lot of that.
How many meets have you had so far this spring?
We've had two. We had one that got canceled because of the snow that came in on that Saturday. So we're, both of them have been at home. We're home this Tuesday. We're undefeated right now. So it's we're off to a good start, but it's going to get tough real quick. We have Seymour at home Tuesday, and you know, they always have a great team, a lot of kids. So we'll go in. I know I'm going to be missing a few guys that you have the play this week. So I've got guys in that are going to be gone. So we'll address it, and then we run Saturday.
You you take your team and you run your meet with whoever you have, and then. Do you see yourself, you know, looking at guys and thinking, you know what, this one I didn't expect and now they finished, or this one I expect and they didn't get to that point? You know, you talk about addressing, you know, the good and the bad. Sometimes it's difficult for kids to get that constructive criticism on, he didn't really do what you needed to do.
Yeah, it is, especially the younger guys or new guys. And I know last week, we had a real hard workout on Monday before the meet because we had a decent day.
Right.
You know, we're looking, we're practicing through these first few meets. You know, that's kind of how you have to look at it now because we're so far behind. And it's tough for a kid to understand that, you know, wow, I just had one of the hardest workouts and I got to run a race tomorrow. You know, and their legs are dead and that kind of stuff. But then when you talk to them about it and explain, listen, your workout was probably harder than the guy you ran against. Now, in the end, guess what? You're going to be where you need to be when we start resting compared to where some of the other guys are, where they're, you know, resting for the meet, which I mean, they do mean something, but it's in the end that really matters.
You mentioned numbers earlier. Your numbers okay?
Yeah, we're 31. I was hoping for a few more guys this year, but you know, it's a good number. We have, let's see, in a couple weeks we have the Seymour invite. So, you know, as we get into some of the big meets, we have to, you know, only send our top two. So, you know, with 31, most of the guys are going to be going to those meets and getting a chance to either see them being an alternate or participating. So, you know, that gets a lot of great experience for the guys, too, as we head into the tournament part of the season.
You have a good mix of upperclassmen and...
Yeah, we've got, I think it's 10 seniors or so, and then about, you know, freshmen were down a little bit this year. You know, you get classes like that, but you get a few more and that kind of stuff. But, yeah, we're pretty balanced across the board.
Every coach loves seniors, hates to see them go. but always looks for that new crop of freshmen coming in. And, you know, we talked about the junior high just a little bit ago. But seeing that cycle of, you know, we're going to have more seniors than freshmen, or we're going to have more freshmen than seniors, and that's just the way it works.
Yeah, it is. And yeah, this year's going to be a tough one for me with my son running and all that and seeing that. And I don't know how I'll do the banquet and senior night, but we'll get through it. You know, I guess because of that, this group will always really have a special place.
Sure.
So
you, you guys, again, you mentioned about 10 seniors. Has anybody really in your mind kind of stuck out that you want to mention this morning?
Yeah, Otto Kling has thrown for me for 4 years, undefeated this year. He is right now ranked about 20th in the state. So he's on that bubble. The problem for him is when we go to Bloomington for the regionals, it's probably one of the toughest discus regionals in the state, kind of like pole vault was for Nick Palmer.
Sure. Sure.
Those kind of things where you have some of the best around. So he's going to have to probably get up to about 150 to have a legitimate shot of getting out, which, you know, he's very capable.
Sure.
He's on that bubble right now of popping a big one and getting it. And so he's having a great season. Brewer Gage, he's doing really well. You know, he's anchoring a lot of our relay teams and things like that. And you know, I could put him anywhere and score points. And you know, he's gone over. We're kind of short on high jumpers this year, and he said, "I'll do it, coach." You know, I mean, just he'll do anything for the team. Winters is doing really well with the hurdles and stuff. So you know, you look through him with Brewer and Dallas Birchfield and Cam Klein. They're both throwers. My son, of course, and Noah Jackson, Teeter. You know, Teeter's our only pole vaulter right now, and I think he went 9 foot the other night with very minimal practice so far because of the weather. And you know, so we've got a great group of seniors, and like you said, you'll hate to see him go.
Yeah, you coaching your son. Is it difficult? More difficult? How's it work? For you?
It is, because when I go home and give him suggestions, I don't know anything. But, you know, that's just kind of the way it is. The good thing is he's a distance runner. I coach the sprint, so then I can go to my distance coach and say, you know, tell him. I better not say what I wanted to, but,
that's
you
right.
know, then he gets the message through another coach, so he listens to them.
Yeah, I understand. I know how that works. That's fantastic. And you mentioned your home Tuesday night, is that right?
Yes, yeah, we're home Tuesday against Seymour, and then we go Saturday to Brown County. It's the Talon Relays, which is a great meet for everybody. It's kind of, we can rest some guys, but yet run. Everything's relays, so field events, you put the top, your two guys together, and they add their distances. There's a lot of other regular relays that we don't run, like the sprint medley and the 4x mile and things like that. So it gives the younger guys a chance. They, you know, can score some points toward their letter and things like that.
And then Hoosier Hills Conference has a tourney, is that right?
Yeah. We will run the Hoosier Hills Conference. It's about the second Thursday of the month, and it's at Seymour this year.
Yeah, and then, of course, everybody's, well, you talked about this at the top of the show, everybody's working towards sectional coming up in May.
Yeah, and, you know, we go down to Jeffersonville and you know, They did get beat a couple years ago by Silver Creek, 46, 47 years in a row they'd won it.
Right.
I was hoping to be the first, but that didn't happen. We've come close.
Yeah.
It's tough going down there with them.
But the kids understand, and the kids realize that what you're doing now is you're building for that particular point.
Yeah, and I've had some of my new guys and even the older guys, you know, they're already talking about sectionals, you know, now. To get out of sectionals, it's the top three, right? And I said, yes and no, it's the top three, and then the four best after that out of the sectionals. Mm-hmm. And so we pull out of Bloomington North, Terre Haute, and Seymour.
Yeah.
And so then they'll look at times, and then the best last four places, or four, get to make it on to regionals, and then the top three get out of regionals.
Coach, we appreciate you being on this morning. Best of luck, not only Tuesday, but the rest of the season.
I appreciate it. Thank you. you.
All right. Coach Scott Holcroft, Madison Boys Track Coach here at Coach's Corner, live from McDonald's on Madison's Hilltop. That'll do it for this edition. I think we're going to talk baseball, Madison baseball, next Saturday, if I remember correctly, with Coach Tim Armstrong, live from McDonald's here at 9 a.m. We do it every Saturday here at 744 Clifty Drive. Thanks for tuning us in to Coach's Corner, live from McDonald's. Thanks to A.J. Bramer in studio. I'm Tim Torrance here on WORX 96.7.